I think most of our audience has been anxiously awaiting the new album, man. What were you going after when you began to record Undercover?
Well, we started off to write, Keith and I were doing demos, but we did have a specific idea in mind. Like, we didn't say, well, we're going to make this a romantic album or whatever. But, you know, as we wrote the songs and Keith and I came and we played them to each other, sort of six or seven songs came out and formed the basis of it, you know.
The only real difference I think about the way we put this album together is that the first time in maybe 10 years or so that Mick and I actually got together for a few weeks before we went in the studio and worked up a few of the songs rather than walking in there and winging it, you know. They think we know what we're doing, but you know, that's the part of the game, you know. As long as the band thinks they know what they're doing, they'll play, you know. But in actual fact, we're writing it on the spot. But this time, it was the first time in, it must be about 10 years, that Mick and I really sat down together for a few weeks and got four or five of the songs actually. Mick and I knew them before we went in the studio.
Keep rushing. The smell of sex has been a suicide. All these dream things I can't keep inside. Undercover, all I say. Undercover, I'm a
You and Keith have known each other since you were both 6 years old. What's the bond that keeps your friendship together after 20 years?
Well, I think is, first of all, is music, you know, and then the band itself, and what the way we, Keith and I, kind of, in a way, direct the way it's going. Now, I'm not saying that the rest of the band don't say they do rather loudly, say quite often. And our sort of friendship, though obviously we've had lots of disagreements. Most of them have been over the band, you know, rather than personal ones. I guess that's it, you know. It's very hard to define what keeps friends. I'm sure everyone's got friends and they're like, why am I friends with this guy? I mean, you know, you don't know. And you get on, sometimes you get on great, and then there's a period where you're not maybe getting on so well. But it's like friendships lasted for 36 years or something. It's quite a long time.
The Stones have, I guess, always been considered the trendsetters of the 60s. What do you think of...
What about 70s?
Well, 70s and 70s.
What about the 80s?
And in the 80s, okay. Right, well, what about today's trendsetters in the 80s? What do you think of it?
I think there's a lot of really good bands about. A lot of good music coming out. A lot better than the punk era. I don't like to use those names, but that's... I relate to that. And I didn't really think the music made it. You know, the image did, but the music didn't in the punk era. But now, like, there's a lot of really good new bands coming out. And a lot of bands that have been around 3 or 4 years, really hot stuff, and I make sure I listen to quite a lot of it.
Well,
I hope you do.
You can once say that rock and roll is about sex and risk, and do you live with that myth?
Yeah, sex and cars and risks. Yeah, yeah. Sure. Absolutely.
Do you see the Stones today as a pop group, or do you still think of them as really the heart of, I guess, along with Bob Seger, a blues rock band, and still that?
I know, we've been called everything.
You
know,
well, how do you see it?
How do I see it? It's very, because to me, they're just the Stones, they're the lads, you know. I mean, I don't think, I'm going to, you know, see that rhythm, my rhythm and blues band, or rock and roll, but particularly, I suppose, when it comes down to it, I'll be happy with rock and roll. Mm-hmm.
Everybody, welcome to the third part in my Stones in the 80s album deep dive series. And today that means I'm talking about their third studio album of the 1980s, Undercover. Now, this, I gotta admit, this is an album that I haven't listened to in a very long time. And even when I listened to it, probably wasn't more than once or twice, and then I just kind of put it aside. So for me, I was kind of revisiting this album because I hadn't heard it in a while. And there are certain albums where, you know, back then you thought, album's okay, or maybe you think it's kind of a weak album for whatever reason. And then you revisit it and you're like, this album is actually better than I remember. I can't believe I ever thought this was a weak album. Maybe it sounds fresh with a new set of ears or with some time passing, and you have a more favorable impression of the album than you did maybe the first couple times that you heard it. This is not the case with this album. This album is pretty terrible. I gotta admit, I do not care for this album much at all. I listened to it again, and I gotta say, this album runs out of steam very early on. Like three songs in, you're already ready for it to be over. And that's how I felt with this album. And a lot of these songs, it was like, okay, I'm done with this song now. How much time is left? And there'd still be a minute and a half left in the song. So it suffers for a variety of reasons. And some of the backstory on this album is, for most of the 70s, Keith Richards was too fucked up on drugs to really be in any position to steer the direction of the band. And so Mick Jagger had to pick up the slack, take on most of the writing, most of the composing, most of the decisions that were made in terms of which direction the band was going in, what the music was going to sound like. That was mostly Mick Jagger. Well, Keith Richards got clean more or less, and he was more focused, his head was clear, and he was ready to start taking more of an active role in the development of the new Stones album. Well, Mick Jagger had become very comfortable steering the direction of the band for the last three or four albums, and he wasn't really ready to give over to control. His idea for the Stones is he thought the Stones should stay caught up on contemporary pop trends. There was the new wave, which was really taking hold. You had MTV, which had burst onto the scene. There was more kind of club, electronic, all these different styles of music that Mick Jagger felt that the Stones should be on the cutting edge of. Stones had recorded reggae back in the 70s, and now reggae was kind of coming back into style, so he wanted to bring back more of that dub or reggae influence. Keith Richards wanted the band to get back to their harder rocking blues roots. So they were butting heads, not for the first time, not for the last time, but this would be the start of a rift that would last into the rest of the decade. So they were not getting along in the studio, and as a result, you can tell on these recordings, it's very unfocused. This album sounds like a tug of war was going on, because you got some stuff that kind of harkens back to the reggae stuff, the disco stuff they were doing as far back as Black and Blue. You had some of that after an absence for the Tattoo You album. You had more of that reggae influence, more of the disco type sounds. But then you've also got the Rolling Stones, kind of like the harder rocking stuff that Keith Richards liked to play. So there's this battle between it all. And that's not to say it would really, it could work. It could have worked, I should say, because there's nothing wrong. I mean, we saw it with Black and Blue. Black and Blue has some rocking stuff on it, and it's got a variety of different styles. Same with Emotional Rescue. But for this album, the problem was they didn't have any solid hooks. There was nothing really memorable coming out of these sessions. Nothing that would stick with you beyond the first listen. That's why I couldn't remember a lot of these songs. When I was going through, before I heard it again, I'm like, I don't remember hardly any of these songs except for Undercover of the Night and She Was Hot. And honestly, after having listened to them now, I'm not really in any hurry to go back and listen to them again. It's just a mess of an album. And it's really disappointing coming after the Tattoo You sessions that this was the best that they could come out with. But we're talking the early 80s here, and styles changed. Production styles changed. They brought a producer in. They brought him into the sessions because from the time they had recorded Tattoo You, the entire music scene had changed. So they wanted to bring a producer in to help them stay relevant, to help them kind of navigate through these new waters that they were in the early 80s. But even with the new producer, if the songs aren't there, there's not a whole lot a producer can do to clean things up. And I guess that's my problem, is just the songwriting on this album was weak. For the first time in a while, they went into the studio not having tracks that had already been recorded that they just needed to perform some overdubs on or add some embellishments to. They went in and started writing songs from scratch. And unfortunately, for whatever reason, the songs do not appear to have been there. So is this a piece of shit album? No, I'm not going to go that far. No, it's not. This is not a dumpster dive. I don't hate it that much. But I got to tell you, it is probably my least favorite Rolling Stones album. And that's disappointing because I really want to get excited about an album when I'm doing a deep dive like this. But for this one, I'm listening to it like, yeah, this album is just not very good. So where do we even start? All right, let's get into the songs on this record. The album opens with Undercover of the Night, which was the first single, and this was written primarily by Mick Jagger. The music was written in collaboration with Ron Wood and Charlie Watts. Keith Richards really had nothing to do with this song. Lyrically, it deals with political corruption in Central and South America. And as a single goes, this one only reached number 9 in the U.S. and number 11 in the U.K., which had to be a disappointment. But I mean, come on, really, listening to this song, it does not scream for radio play. It's not all that catchy. It's got just a pretty pedestrian guitar line. Some cool bass work from Bill Wyman. I do like that part of the song, but otherwise, it just kind of struggles to be anything other than a very cool groove, which a lot of these songs do. And for the most part on this album, Jagger is singing in a very aggressive, kind of a harsh voice. He's not mixing it up a lot like he's done on previous albums. Do I hate the song? No. Am I in love with it? I'm not in love with it, no. But it's okay. It's just probably one of the weakest lead-off singles. just the topic of this song was not going to connect with the general public, and it was not going to go racing up the charts. So it is what it is. The next track, She Was Hot, seems to be a counterpoint to She's So Cold from the Emotional Rescue album. And we're back to, again, the rockabilly, twangy guitar, kind of been there, done that feel to this song. Probably one of the better songs on this album, truthfully. And two songs in, it's like, okay, we got a pretty strong album so far going here. This song sounds like it could have just as easily been released in the late 70s as 1983. And that's probably one of the reasons why I like it. The next song is Tie You Up, The Pain of Love. And a lot of these songs on here have this violent imagery. For some reason, they seem to be obsessed with this whole bondage pain kind of thing for this album. Just violence in general. And I'm not honestly sure a lot what he's talking about. Is he talking about the pain of regular love and just heartbreak? Or is he actually talking about whips and chains and all that stuff? Seems to be a little bit of a mixed bag as far as that goes. But this is a song that establishes a great groove, but it doesn't really go anywhere. There's no meaty hook. There's no catchy chorus. It just kind of plods along. There's no payoff. It's like the Stones going through the motions. And again, Jagger with that super macho, hyper-aggressive voice that he uses. I mean, this song doesn't scream 80s to me. It's not a terrible song. It's just not very memorable. If you're programming a Stones playlist, this song is probably not going to be part of it. Next track is a Keith song. He sings it, I Want to Hold You. Now, I'm very forgiving when it comes to Keith's tracks. Are they the best tracks on the Stones catalog? Generally, no, although I do tend to like most of them. This is not one of them. I don't care for this song. The lyrics are pretty weak and average, especially with Keith singing. Keith Richards is singing about wanting to hold you. And it's basically, I don't have a lot of money, I don't have a lot to give you, but I can give you a hug. I can give you a great big hug and hold you. And lyrics aside, this song has nothing to offer. I think the verses are average. I think the chorus is kind of lame. I mean, typically Keith Richards songs, there's some kind of charm to them. They're a little bit of a novelty on the Stones records, but this one just doesn't do anything. There's no magic here. Song on side one, Feel On Baby, is the Stones returning to the reggae sound. And I'll be honest, it's a piece of garbage. Really, the lyrics are so ridiculously trite and lame. When I travel coast to coast, you're the hookup I miss the most. Like, is that mixed idea of flattery? And this one definitely has an 80s feel to it. There's no mistaking. When I said before about how Mick wanted the Stones to try and sound contemporary, he was offering up songs like this. And I think the Stones' attempts at reggae have always been a mixed bag, but this one definitely misses the mark. And it's a weak and very unsatisfying way to close out the first side of the record. Side two opens with Too Much Blood, and I gotta say, what is the point of this song? The lyrics are so bizarre and they're so violent. It's got me scratching my head, honest to God. Oh yeah, this friend of mine, he found this girl, took her back to his apartment, chopped her body up into pieces. It's like, this is your friend you're talking about? Like, what the hell? Who do you keep company with?
A friend of mine was just Japanese. He had a girlfriend in Paris. He had to date her for 6 months. And then eventually, she said yes. You know, took her to his apartment, cut off her head, put the rest of her body in the refrigerator, and her piece by piece. Put her in the refrigerator, put her in the freezer, and when her ate her, took her bones to the Bois de Boulogne. By chance, taxi driver noticed him, burying the bone.
Then he goes on talking about the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. It's like, it's so bizarre.
You ever see the Texas Chainsaw Massacre? Horrible, wasn't it? You know, people ask me, is it really true? You know, where you live in Texas, is that really true? What they do around there, people? I say, you know, every time I drive through the crossroads, I get scared. There's a bloke running around with a fucking chainsaw. No!
Okay, I changed my mind about this album. I mean, the music is somewhat interesting, but you're just too focused on the lyrics. Like, am I actually listening to this? What is he talking about? The next song is pretty beat up. And this one, it's not what you think it's about. It's not actually beating somebody up. It's just somebody talking about a breakup and feeling pretty beat up after the breakup. The music itself sounds like Sophistopop, a little bit like the Style Council or something like that. There's a lot of horns on this song. I mean, it's okay. I'm kind of a Sophistopop guy, so I think musically, it's not all that offensive. But again, it's a song without a hook. They get this groove going, but there's just nothing to kind of draw you in. And after about 2 minutes of it, it's like, okay, I'm ready to move on. Song is Too Tough, and in general, this is the kind of Rolling Stones song that I do like. In fact, it reminds me a little bit of Jumpin' Jack Flash. It's just a straightforward rock and roll song. My problem with this is that there's really nothing memorable about the chorus. There's no catchy hook again. I do like the general feel of the song. I like that it's one of the most straightforward rock songs on the album. I just wish that it were a little more catchy, that's all.
Try to force the drugs. Circulation's run.
The next song is All the Way Down, and basically it's a song about a blowjob. I am not kidding. That's all it's about. That's where we are with the Stones in 1983, 20 years on from their first album. They're talking about oral sex. But okay, I'm going to be fair. All right, musically, it's okay. Musically, it sounds a bit of new wave, which, okay, I will say that I like the music. So honestly, probably of all the songs on side two, like this one, it's all right. The subject notwithstanding, this song's okay. Okay, the last song is It Must Be Hell. And this is probably the Stones' most political, or at least socially conscious album for what it's worth. But I'm glad they closed it on a high note. I'm glad that they went back to straightforward rock and roll for this one. You got a pretty cool Keith Richards riff. I like the groove that they have going here. Again, this is what I like the Stones to sound like. No screwing around. Just get back to basics and do what you do the best. The chorus could be a little catchier, and I'm not sure that the Stones singing socially conscious songs is a good look for them, but I'm going to give them a pass on this one. I really do like this song. Alright, so anyway, am I being too harsh on this album? Am I just maybe in a bad mood? I don't think so. I mean, I listened to this album twice and it just didn't grow on me. Is it awful? No, but I just come to expect more with the Stones. And there's really, if I had to sum it up in one word, I would say disappointing. So anyway, thanks for watching. Hope you're enjoying this series. And unfortunately, I wish I could say I'm looking forward to the next album, but I'm kind of not looking forward to that one either. But we'll soldier forward nonetheless. Take care.